En el año internacional de la sanidad
In the
vegetal,
International Plant Year of Plant Health, we would like to tell you about our greatest challenge. From SENASA, Argentina, we work on that challenge every day. We take care of plants because plants produce 80% of the food we eat. They provide the oxygen we breathe. By taking care of it, we protect the environment.
También preservamos la economía de miles de familias.
We also protect the economy of thousands of households. How do we do it? At SENASA, we work on prevention and control of pests that can damage our plants.
¿Sabías que en el mundo se pierde?
Did you know that in the world, 40% of annual crops are lost due to plant diseases?
Entre todos tenemos que cuidarlas.
We all need to take care of plants. We work to bring food safety to each table, to help crops grow in the field, to improve the economy of every household, to keep open a new path and show ours to the world. Let's plant the future by protecting plants and protecting life.
Good morning to all of you. Welcome to the virtual conference. It's a second regional cooperation seminar for Latin America and the Caribbean, which is part of our cycles on locus, situation, and technical cooperation standpoint. I'm Loretta Gorna. I am the General Directorate of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Trade, and Worship of the Argentine Republic, together with Paula Cuthbert from the National Service of Health and Food Quality, SENASA, will be moderating today's meeting. The objective of the seminar is to exchange experiences and look at new ways of dealing with locusts, pests, and plagues and outbreaks within the framework which was determined by the FAO, the International Year of Plant Health. We are going to have four panels. An opening panel, a panel to exchange information, to learn about current successful experiences in the region. Then we will hold an open discussion where the public can ask questions and the panel will answer. Then we will begin now with Minister Alicia Brun, who is from the General Directorate of the International Cooperation, DG CIN, Ministry of Foreign Affairs. You have the floor. Thank you, Antonieta. Welcome to all. On behalf of the International Cooperation Department of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Argentina, we hereby welcome you. We thank you for taking part in this second seminar on regional cooperation, which is part of a cycle of seminars for oversight of locusts. The objective of this meeting is to speak about the status of the situation in Latin America and the Caribbean, to share experiences of successful cooperation efforts, and exchange cooperation perspectives throughout the region. I would like to take advantage to thank Dr. Manuel Otero, Director General of the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation in Agriculture, IGA, for his support and for disseminating this activity. Carlos Paz, engineer and president of National Service of Health and Food Quality of Argentina, SENASA, for participating and the joint collaboration in planning the seminar. And the Argentinian Ministry of Agriculture and Fisheries for taking part. Diana Guillen, who is part of the cabinet, and the president of the Plant Health Committee of the Southern Cone, COSAVE, and coordinator of the Inter-American Group on Plant and Animal Health, Cesar de la Cruz. I especially thank the participation of delegates from regional plant health protection organizations of Latin America and the Caribbean, COSAVE, CANE, ORIRSA, CAFSA, and NAPO, that will give us an updated view on the situation with locusts that does not pay heed to any borders. As head of cooperational efforts of the Republic of Argentina, we promote bilateral and triangular efforts to face common challenges on a horizontal manner and mutual benefit. We work with other state organizations in defining strategies and cooperation programs tied to development programs of our partners and the productive sector for sustainable development that is inclusive for all communities of the world. We strike partnerships with regional and international cooperation organizations such as ICA, with whom we are negotiating a memorandum of understanding for triangular cooperation program to provide joint technical know-how to Latin America and the Caribbean. Within this specific situation, we've focused our efforts on seeking innovative mechanisms that are creative to be able to face challenges imposed by the pandemic. The seminar responds to our will to continue to exchange experiences and best practices, although it is virtual. One of the threats, of course, of this pest is to threaten the food security of the region. That is why we need to respond in an international manner to be able to face this pest and other food security threats. I wish you all a great work session. Thank you. Thank you, Madam Minister. I'm going to give the floor now to Dr. Manuel Otero, Director General of ICA. Thank you so much. Good morning to all of the attendees. I would like to welcome Ms. Minister Alicia Barone, General Directorate of the International Cooperation of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Mr. Carlos Paz, President of SENASA, and all of the authorities at this prestigious institution, Diana Guillen, Cabinet Head of the Argentinian Ministry of Livestock and Agriculture, and all of the representatives from ORIRSA, CAN, NAPO, and I can't forget employ our authorities at ICA, who have all endeavored to make sure that this activity runs smoothly. I'd like to emphasize the economic impact of locusts on food production and natural areas, and has a significant impact at a highlight to this voracious pest and its cross-border migratory nature, which requires national efforts to put it under control. And a recent study carried out by ICA in Argentina shows that the regions of northwestern Argentina and northeastern Argentina are the ones most likely to be affected by locusts. We're speaking here that the value of agricultural production of the main crops in these regions is around 3.7 billion, not including orchards, industrial crops, natural pastures of and annual forages used in livestock production. If we also consider the massive impact on grazing land and pasture land and grazing land in this area, and the high costs and difficulties dealing with logistics, where there are fewer pools and vulnerable producers, well, they would be the most affected. ICA has been working on this since the 1970s, and Given its 78-year history, it is concerned with supporting the different countries of the continent in identifying strategies for preventing and controlling this pest through concrete and high impact initiatives, such as providing support for capacity building and incorporating new technologies to respond to emergencies. The latest outbreaks state that at a national level, our efforts are not enough, and there's a cyclical nature of this pest, which makes it difficult to manage. The countries are organizing themselves in different manners with different strategies to prevent dissemination and be able to control this pest by creating a diverse wealth of experiences in order to disseminate that, since this will give us strength to face these pests in an integrated fashion. The strategy of this pest is also, strategies of dealing with this pest are also leading to different levels of experience that we must share, because models must be replicated to be able to benefit our farmers. In the past few years, and given this problem at ICA, we have formulated different initiatives, some national initiatives, but most regional ones. Let me remind you that ICA is the directorate of the Southern Cone and Procisur. And we have to make sure that ICA does support all efforts for promotions and integration to defend our farmers. That's why we identify opportunities for cooperation that are directed at strengthening response capacities, where the state plays a leading role, but also support for productive sectors under a focus on public-private partnerships. Given the fact that we're facing a high-risk pest, let me reiterate that it's wonderful to be working with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the Ministry of Agriculture, SENASA in Argentina, together with COSAVA and the Inter-American Group of Plant Health Protection, and to be able to form consortiums and work together. And recently, the Minister Brona mentioned that there was an event for Mercosur in August, held on August 28th, a hemispheric event. And how about being able to exchange experiences with Africa on November 20th? We're developing also a virtual course, and we hope to be able to develop more experiences for the private sector in this area. Thank you for taking us into account. I invite that you all participate actively in the seminar, remembering that we all have to contribute, because the only way of overcoming this pest that causes changes to the map of pests and threats to our agriculture. Have a wonderful weekend. Thank you, Dr. Otero. I'm going to give the floor to Carlos Paz, President of the National Food and Health Service, SENAT. Thank you, Antonieta. I'd like to welcome all of you who are attending this meeting today, specifically Dr. Manuel Otero, who I've known for many years now, and I've been lucky to be able to work with him. Ambassador Alicia Barón, Minister Alicia Barón, former ambassador, it's truly wonderful to include the Foreign Affairs Ministry of Argentina at this event. I also see Lourdes Fonacera. She worked at SENASA, and now we continue to work together while she is now at ICA. We work on different issues that are of interest to ICA and for the task that SENASA carries out in Argentina. As Dr. Otero mentioned, after 60 years in Argentina, for example, in 2015, we're facing this transborder pest once again. It reappeared in the country. And let me highlight, this is a very different scenario. When we speak about the old pest from the 40s and 50s, 1940s, 50s. This was another country, and the area that Dr. Otero mentioned was the northern part of Argentina, the NOA that we call, the northwestern side and the northeastern side, the NEA. And these were federal territories back then. They were not provinces with their own autonomy as they are today. Our oversight strategy, thus, was based on what we deemed, well, national services provided for this purpose. Our efforts were focused on expeditions from the capital, Buenos Aires, where we would trek all the way to the areas with these pests, Rioja, Dinamarca, Chaco, Formosa. Today, we're still dealing with the outputs of these efforts. But we still have some pending items at SENASA with regards to this scenario. So the context changed tremendously, and the awareness of our farmers and the community in dealing with this type of pest also changed. But in addition to our federal organizational structure, I wanted to specify the following. Production in that area that faces locusts also changed. Argentina changed its livestock and crop orders, and many times at the expense of native species. So it broadened its expansion of this area. And this should also be part of a study. For example, what happens when ecosystems intervene or ecosystems are impacted as they have been in the past 20 to 25 years in these endangered areas. And in Paraguay and Bolivia, we are facing very similar scenarios. Given that change in our context, we have to work in a more integrated fashion. So SENASA no longer carries out those expeditions from Buenos Aires. SENASA is regionalized, so there are regional teams in different areas of the country, but we cannot undermine that the help of INTA, for example, and other international organizations and national organizations, as well as municipalities, play their part in helping us in these efforts. With the last outbreak in Cordoba of these pests, this happened during the pandemic, and we're lucky to be able to communicate with the province, with the provincial security forces, and work as a team. And of course, we had full participation of the farmers, which is key in these types of interventions. We need to communicate with them very early with regards to curbing this pest. Well, the swarm that came in from Uruguay and went through Santa Fe, well, we had to wait to be able to deal with them and fight them, the different currents of these locusts, and they ended in Northern Rios in a citrus production area where, according to the Producer Federation and INTA, we were able to control them in the fields and in the orchards, and the farmers themselves were in charge of the oversight. Now, just a separate item to mention, and this was proposed by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and ICA. Well, we need to work in a regional manner. In practice, we coordinate well and must be able, however, be learned and be able to work in a better manner with our regional programs. The ATRIES program, for example, worked together with the border countries, and this was key for monitoring and just to learn where the swarm was heading. When the swarms entered Argentina, when they entered, we communicated with Brazil and Uruguay immediately with regards to that risk, because we were thinking that the swarms could enter Brazil and Uruguay. And this is a reflection of coordinated efforts among the area and the different countries. And as a result of this, Brazil has offered to provide airplanes to be able to carry out oversight. Luckily, we didn't have to reach these extremes. But it does show how important bilateral cooperation is. And we need this to monitor the pest and to establish oversight mechanisms. Now, another essential part of our efforts, and my team is working on this, is training. We've been asked by other Latin American countries for information. We are always responding to questions and from our neighbors, and unfortunately, the pandemic prevents us from meeting with them, but luckily, we have been able to cover these information gaps through virtual meetings. We also mentioned COSAVE, the Southern Cone, the Plant Health Committee of the Southern Cone. And they've shown how able they are to be able to achieve consensuses among the different countries. And this is important for dealing with an issue as important as this pest control. So I'd like to thank SENASA for their excellent work since 2015 in these efforts. A very solid group of locust experts was formed. They're working very well. They're obtaining information. The interpreter apologizes. There are some sound gaps.
Hola, al parecer, como que tuvimos un problema.
It seems that we have a technical issue with Mr. Paz. Mr. Paz?
Hola, don Carlos.
Mr. Paz, I'm sorry to interrupt. Antonieta, let's continue with the agenda while we resolve Mr. Paz's technical issue. I apologize for the technical issues. Thank you so much, Mr. Paz, for your remarks and for the other authorities that preceded him. That's life with the internet. Well, for the public who is viewing us on different platforms and social networks, you can definitely ask questions. We are broadcasting this through SENASA's YouTube channel, Facebook, and IGA. So be sure to ask questions. When you do ask questions on these platforms, just don't forget to mention what country you're from and what institution you represent. Thank you, Paula, you have the floor.
Thank you, Antonieta. I'm sure that
if Mr. Paz wants to intervene later, we can certainly give him an opportunity. And now we will continue with our work. And we have a first presentation by the representative of the Inter-American Co-op Coordinating Group on Plant Health. And we will now give the floor to the COSAVE delegate. Thank you, Paula. And I would like to thank all the authority for their opening remarks. In the first presentation, I will tell you very briefly what are our working objectives of the technical locust and grasshoppers group. It's comprised of different plant health regional institutions, CAPSA, CAN, COSAVO, NAPO, and OIRSA. This group is to coordinate actions to prevent the dissemination and introduction of pests. A continental coordination forum for the development of standards and phytosanitary guidelines to facilitate trade through the promotion of disciplines, principles, and objectives of the SPS WTO agreement and the IPPC. Also, important phytosanitary problems and proposed strategies to strengthen phytosanitary protection in the Americas. Currently, this group has six technical groups, for example, certification group, the fruit fly group, Oxipodo group, and the sixth group that we're going to address right now is the locust and grasshopper group. The objective of this group is to analyze and to report on the situation of locusts and grasshoppers and strengthen cooperation between regions of the American continent with each other and with other international organizations and specialists in the field to improve preventive management systems and emergency response. To give you an example, a few of our specific objectives, we have to prepare and compile technical reference documents on the locust and grasshopper problems in a coordinated continent, harmonize existing preventive management plans, contingencies and emergencies to unify criteria and work procedures in the different regions of our continent. Also, implement information systems that allow the sharing of information from the different regions, improve the detection and issue early warnings. A key objective to strengthen technical capabilities in each region and country is to make visible and support the implementation of workshops and courses to strengthen the technical capacity. Recently at OIRSA organized a workshop on locust with a preventive approach. And here you can see some pictures to your right of a seminar that was held in Argentina in 2017 with the participation of different countries from the continent and support from IICA. To your left, you can see a in the field training by OIRSA or in an event organized by OIRSA Nicaragua. Another key objective is that as an in regional plant health organization, we need to understand what our position is and the different roles we have. Together with the other regional plant health organizations, we believe that we must have the capacity to identify what are the research needs. And based on that common identification, we need to contact different researchers around the world to bring new tools to improve the management of this pest. These are some lines of work that we have prioritized. We need to have a single mobile monitoring system to reduce work times. Also promote the use of geographic information systems promote the use of satellite images and models to issue early warnings, and also promote and validate the use of unmanned aerial vehicles for monitoring and control of this type of pests. What documents have been produced by this group? Here you can see a map of the locust species distribution and the four types of locust in the continent. We can see the Central American locust and the South American locust, Piceifrons, Piceifrons peruviana, Interrita, and Cancellata. These are the four types that have been identified in our continent. We have also prepared some technical sheets for this species of locust, describing very briefly some general traits of this species and their distribution in our region. We have also prepared a status report on the risk levels for these four species in the continent. Here you can see a map with different colors indicating the different risk levels and also a country description of what is happening with the locust and grasshoppers. You will be hearing about this later on during this seminar. Finally, locusts are considered one of the most important pests in the world. As we mentioned before, these are transboundary migratory pests, so they require coordination and joint work by all the countries affected. We need to unify efforts and work jointly in order to contain these pests of locusts and grasshoppers. I would like to thank all the organizers and all the people that are working in this project, also GOSAVE and IICA for their permanent support, and especially to Miss Lourdes Cunellera. Thank you. Thank you, Hector. And now we will move on with the second presentation, where we will be listening to experts from GOSAVE, the Andean community, OIRSA, Caribbean Agricultural Health and Food Safety Agency, CAFSA, and NAPO, to address the status of the different species mentioned by Hector in Latin America and the Caribbean. We would like to give the floor to Mr. Solano, GOSAVE representative. Good morning to all. I will present a brief description of the current situation of this pest in GOSAVE. As Hector mentioned, GOSAVE is an intergovernmental organization comprising different regional plant health organizations in the area. This includes Argentina, Bolivia, Brazil, Chile, Paraguay, Peru, and Uruguay. As part of the issues that the organization addresses since the resurgence of Schizotera cancellata in 2015, we decided to create a technical task force to address the locust issue in the continent. Next slide, please. As for the distribution, the previous slide, please. For the distribution of locusts around the world, we have some particular issues with one locust species, Schistocerca. Most of these species are located in the American continent. And here we have the genus Schistocerca, and these may become locust. We have Schistocerca piscifortis, Schistocerca piscifrons peruviana, Schistocerca interrita, and Schistocerca cancellata. And the region is currently affected by these species in their gregarious phase, and plant health organizations need to take action to control the pest. Next slide, please. In general, in the southern region of the Cosaba region, the previous slide, please. We have locust in the gregarious phase. The previous slide, please. The gregarious phase of in Argentina, Bolivia, and Paraguay. As of 2015, we had a resurgence of these species, and these affected these countries. As a result of that, Brazil, Uruguay, and Chile declared an emergency alert, even though they have not received these pests in their territory. We also need to give follow-up to Conapis clariciana in Argentina. High levels have been detected of Covirales pularis in Argentina, Bolivia, and Paraguay. Also in Huaquingo, in Chile, the Lagudero worm has been detected in this area. Also, you will hear this in the camp presentation. In 2017, we had an initial gregarious phase in northern Peru. Next slide, please. As Hector mentioned, in COSAVE, we have a technical task force that has committed to establish general guidelines to control and monitor these pests, prepare technical sheets for each species under official control, also prepare a list of the different insecticides and control mechanisms. And this is a task that may be carried out by all the different plant health regional organizations, and also an exchange of experiences in order to improve field work. This technical task force also holds intergovernmental meetings to control Schistocerca cancellata with the participation of Argentina, Bolivia, and Paraguay. We hope that we will be able to have some technical documents on the medium term to help the countries in the region control this type of pest. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your presentation. Don't forget to ask your questions through the different platforms. That way the panel can answer them afterwards. So now we're going to hear Cesar Luis Espinosa Vizca, delegate of CAN, the Indian community. Good morning. Would you mind being able to control the slide? Thank you. For the slides.
Bien, muchas gracias.
Very well, thank you. As representative of the Andean community, let me begin.
Las acciones y situación actual que se tiene
This is the current situation or current status and context with regards to certain locust species that impact the region. CAN deals with three species of locusts that are officially under control. Two of these are in Peru, which is Schistocerca interita and Schistocerca viserifons peruviana. The Schistocerca interita is found more in the Lambayeca region and Schistocerca piscifons peruviana is found towards the Cajamarca in the Amazon region. Although these pests aren't currently causing too much damage in the aforementioned areas, well, given the prevention efforts of SENASA to prevent that they prevent a rise and that they become gregarious, then, especially with Schistocerca cancellata, for example, which is now being monitored continuously, and that has to do with the different types of threats or latent foci in Argentina. So we coordinate with Argentina constantly, because as a region, we have to be vigilant in the event of an outbreak and prevent an outbreak. There are two other locust species that are not officially under control, but they do have, they are considered to be of significant economic importance. They're latent. The concern is always there to prevent their spread. See, they do tend to occupy the same area as Schistocerca cancellata, Tucura quebrachera, and Tucura rayada. And there's Tropidactylus scolaris and Chromacris speciosa, and that's in the Chaco region. Assessments are currently underway to prevent economic negative economic impact on livestock and agriculture, and based on these species. The current scenario of locusts in the CAN region. Well, Schistocerca interita has been continuously addressed, as I mentioned, with continuous oversight and monitoring. This prevents swarms or gregarious populations. There are 7,222 hectares that are currently being monitored in the Lavalleja region and the Iruá region. And Schistocerca piscifons peruviana, for that, more than 11,800 hectares have been controlled. Pesticide applications have been executed in 225 hectares in the Cajamar Amazonia region. Regarding Schistocerca cancellata, SENASA has been able to control more than 12,100 hectares. With monitoring of 81,645 hectares in the Chaco region. It's truly important to highlight the work done by SENASA Peru. It continuously strives to use technology and cover a high volume area. As a result, we are able to effectively work to control areas in the fields. During this presidency, 500 pesticide applicators were able to be purchased for farmers to eradicate the pests in the region.
Mochila de aplicación.
This is the map that shows the distribution I was speaking about. It shows the impact of Schistoserca cancellata and Schistoserca enterata in Peru, as well as Schistoserca peruviana, and that's in Peru. You can see the impact in the Bolivian Chaco region of cancellata. As a result, a plant health emergency was declared in the departments of Santa Cruz, Tarija, and Chiquisaca, which are on the map. And Peru constantly monitors the region to prevent spread of these locusts, of these species. Peru is concerned that the El Niño phenomenon will have that due to the El Niño phenomenon, more outbreaks will occur. And that is why surveillance is continuously being done in a high volume as much as possible. And we've had good results up to now. So that's all the information I have for you from Ken. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you, Cesar, for your presentation. I'm going to ask Dr. Mario Pupic to make his presentation. He's a delegate of OIRSA. Good morning. Would you mind taking control of the presentation for me? Thank you. Before making my presentation, I'd like to thank the organizers for developing such an important event. Undoubtedly, it's truly important and essential in order to provide close collaboration among the different national and regional organizations. This is a transboundary pest, and its management should be handled under this purview. If not, it would be very difficult to manage it through localized control efforts. It has to be handled from a regional perspective. And just while my presentation starts up, just wanted to make that comment. On the screen, we see a picture of the situation that can result from one of the least studied species at a world level. The species that's been most studied are the desert locust in Africa, for example, the coffee locust, etc. Just wanted to mention some general aspects of the Central American locust. And I do thank the institutions that helped us develop this study. OIRSA is comprised by 9 countries. So these 9 countries, as you can see here, are each addressing this threat. Recently, the Dominican Republic was added to the group. This pest has been declared by different countries to be a national pest. Mexico declared it a national pest in 1924, and other countries afterwards, given the importance of the impacts of this pest. So this arose from a problem that we faced 50, 60 years back. OISA has a representative in each of their member countries. It also has a headquarters in El Salvador, San Salvador. So here, I'm going to just read this, because below it says, locusts or grasshoppers that are voracious critters that devastated agriculture in 1940. Mexico, South America, and Panama joined in 1947 and faced a common front of battle against this pest. And luckily, ORISA was founded in 1950 to fight these types of threats. So this just perfectly summarizes what is on the slide. The executive director is Inciensa Efraina, who does a great job at coordinating management of locusts and other plant pests. Throughout the region, there are 2 important species of acarids. To the left, we can observe the true locust, Schistoserca pisirfons, pisirfons. To the left, we observe it there. It's a species that just devastates crops. Below, we can observe the different years of the latest outbreaks, 2016 El Salvador, 2017 Nicaragua, repeated again in 2018. 2019 experienced a sort of recession, but during 2020, due to environmental conditions, there was a, this pest resurged. On July 2nd, 2020, ORISA issued a plant health warning to all of its member countries. So these countries began to decide to carry out a systematic sort of research to be able to find the locust and just to study its current status. I'll give you results soon and the immediate response of the different countries. There's also Tropidacris that shares the genus with our South American brothers. That's the Tropidacris cristata variety dux, and it's called the forest grasshopper. They're called chachalacas in Honduras, but it's a significant pest in Honduras and Guatemala and can even devastate production. And Tropidacris, when there aren't any locusts, there's definitely Tropidacris. This is a summary, and I'm not going to read it all, but it just shows the report of the different countries based on this warning or this alert. And what happened was a sampling, and in order to gain control of the locusts, and we can see here the member countries and what they reported. Belize, here we can see, had not been able to control locusts for 50 years now. This occurs due to lack of warning systems. And then you could even say that its development was provoked because it was found on one of the borders of a crop, of a maize crop parcel, And it was sort of a haven for these pests, and control was lost there. And it still hasn't been able to be controlled up, not even now. So in Petenes and Jutiapa in Guatemala, which borders El Salvador, well, different activities were developed to respond. So air and land control is currently taking place right now. Outbreaks have been able to come under control in El Salvador and Nicaragua as well, despite the fact that a large surface of Nicaragua is under control. It's not a various population or high population, but it's in a preventive and solitary transition of status. And Sirtuquela Islands, well, was found in Panama, and the Dominican Republic has not had any locusts as of yet. The map summarizes how the status is observed. It's a traffic light. We see yellow foci in Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras, and Nicaragua. We don't see swarms that are migrating among municipalities or across border country borders. In Belize, Costa Rica are green, and Panama still has not experienced this species, only Cypriocerca pallens. And the second generation, though, can come on strong, so we can't lose sight of better control methods. Look at Guatemala. There is control through drones, through physical applications. In El Salvador and Nicaragua, the military even took part in the sampling efforts. Here we can see the Ministry of Agriculture working in El Salvador with the Minister of Agriculture in going out to take samples. Above, I had mentioned the maize that was the precursor or the cause for the locust to cause an outbreak in Belize. So we see those maize crops up on top. But luckily it was be able to be kept in a smaller area and has not caused many problems afterwards. Some final perspectives. We need to continue to monitor and execute oversight actions for the second generation, which will have more exponential growth. We need to train our current technical team. It's a strong team, but we can't lose sight of updating them with technology transfer, short-term management efforts. We need to strengthen early warning models, develop trial runs to develop, because we need to train our technical team and carry out simulations or drills. We always need to update our knowledge. And then exchange information with plant health protection experts from other countries. Guatemala, for example, visits different areas continuously for that purpose. We need to have a preventive focus, for example, of virtual trainings. We need a kit or short-term action mechanism, early warning systems, and early management systems if it isn't too complicated. National response plans. We have regional plans right now, and we're working on each of the countries developing a locust emergency plan. And of course, to assess the different results on site, when we don't have science and technology to manage locusts, we are going to have to depend on control efforts. So that's why we have to continue to assess on-site results if the pandemic so permits. I'm going to assess this later on. The idea is going out on site, but it's impossible right now with the pandemic. I'd like to thank the organizers and again, our colleague and coordinator of OIRSA. Thank you. Thank you, Doctor, for your presentation. We're going to give the floor to the entomologist, Melvin Bucks, who is a representative of the Caribbean Agricultural Health and Food Safety Agency, CAFSCA.
Hello, good morning, everyone. I bring greetings from CAFSA, Caribbean Agricultural Health and Food Safety Agency. The member states represented by CAFSA are the islands of the Caribbean and include Guyana, Belize, and Suriname. Except for Belize, who is already a member of OIRSA, locusts are not reported as a pest of concern for most islands of the Caribbean. The Central American locust was recorded present in Trinidad, but the species is not reported as a pest of concern in the Caribbean islands. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. For Trinidad, the species of concern is the Moruga grasshopper and the Cedrus grasshopper. The Moruga grasshopper is currently the most serious grasshopper species in the country and recorded as a major pest since 1918. From 2014 to present, there has been increased swarms throughout several communities in South Trinidad and continuous movement out of its natural range from forested areas. The Moruga grasshopper feeds on several cultivated crops and generally cause panic to residents in affected areas. Next slide, please. There are currently no reports of invasions from any species from the South American continent affecting the islands of the Caribbean. Next slide, please. For management of the Moruga grasshopper in Trinidad, Trinidad is working to develop an integrated pest management program with emphasis on biological control. Considering the use of indigenous isolates and evaluating biopesticides from other countries or donor agencies, the possibility also to develop pheromones or repellents. Additionally, to develop a structured surveillance and monitoring program. The key areas identified for capacity building involve identification of grasshopper and locust species in the region, surveillance, and biological control with an emphasis on entomopathogenic fungi. We'd like to thank the organizers for this invitation to participate in the event. Thank you.
Muchas gracias, señor Bach. Para cerrar este segundo
Thank
bloque...
you, Mr. Bach. To close this second block, we are going to give the floor to the NABO delegate, Mr. Jesus Garcia Pedia. Good morning. On behalf of Dr. Javier Trujillo Arriaga Chief Director of SENASICA, and Engineer Francisco Ramirez Ramirez of Plant Health. We would like to extend a cordial greeting to all the participants in this second regional seminar. Next slide, please. NAPO is comprised of three countries, Mexico, Canada, and the United States. It was created in 1976 pursuant to Article 9 of the International Plant Protection Convention. The current executive director is Dr. Stephanie Bohn. NACO is a forum where organizations from public and private sectors conduct actions to protect plant health and facilitate international trade in vegetable products. I believe that Dr. Mario Putz, in his presentation, explained the background of the Central American locust, Schistoseca paecifrons in the region, and the distribution of the Central American locust is from the north and central Mexico to Panama. This pest has affected crops in Mexico for a very long time, even since the epoch of the Mayan communities. There are data that indicate that this was declared as a national pest since colonial times, but it is under official control, and the federal government has undertaken to control this pest. Since 2004, a permanent phytosanitary campaign has been launched in 10 federal entities. Mexico is divided into states and municipalities. In the map to your left, you can see the different municipalities where the Central American locust is located. In the Yucatan Peninsula, we have the largest gregarious area in the area. And since this is a very important pest, in 2020, Mexico is investing $1.1 million to combat this pest. The Central American locust in some regions coexists with Schistoseca pallens and Schistoseca mitens, in addition to Tropidacris, as was clearly explained by Dr. Mario Pols in his presentation. Next slide, please. These are the activities that have been carried out by Mexico in 2020. In spite of the emergency situation posed by COVID-19, we have also been working very hard, and I would like to thank the municipal plant health committees that work in the field, and the state plant health committees support the agricultural secretariat. Here we can see some figures. Over 272,000 hectares have been examined, explored. This is almost twice as the year before. And sampling to collect data on the pest, we have done this in 36,280 hectares, and we have applied control measures in almost close to 14,000 hectares. The cane sugar, the sugar cane sector has conducted on its own some control activities, especially in San Luis Potosí and Veracruz. This is not included in these figures I'm showing because these are activities that were conducted with their own resources. They did not use federal resources. With these strategic actions that are part of the phytosanitary campaign, we are protecting 6 million of cultivated areas. This accounts for 25% of the planted area nationwide. In these regions, over 58 million tons are produced annually with a value close to $3.5 billion. Next slide, please. This is a general map of the situation in Mexico. We have two large areas where we are working very hard to control the pest in the Yucatan Peninsula, where the team is being led by Dr. Mario Put, and the Huasteca region in the Gulf of Mexico, where we have four federal entities, San Luis Potosí, Tamaulipas, Hidalgo, and Veracruz. These regions since had not undertaken any control actions since 2002, but this year they have control over 3,500 hectares. This shows that this is a very good year for the locust to expand. Next slide, please. As for our perspectives, we have two main areas here: strengthening epidemiological surveillance to have timely pest detection and implement warning alerts, and also building the capacity of the technical staff through emergency drills and also face-to-face or online training, as Dr. Mario Potts already mentioned. For these activities, we have support from the other countries, from OIRSA and FAO experts, as well as other experts, locust experts. The purpose is to have continuous improvement of phytosanitary actions. I would like to thank you for inviting me to this seminar.
Thank you, Jesus, and all of the speakers for this block. Do not forget to ask questions, audience. We'll be covering them in the next block. Our third block is now going to be covered by Dr. Mario Poc, who is going to speak about control of locust species in Mexico. Thank you. I'm back, of course. Thank you. We're going to speak about biological control and Mexico's experience in that area, and cooperation on a regional level. Chemical control, which is what comprises most of pest management efforts. Generally, approximately 95% of the treated area is under chemical control, and that's to manage locusts. There are also biological agents that are used. As a result, the locusts die, and we find that chemical control is more effective than biological control. So how does the story start with regards to biological control? Well, this was began in 1997. The idea was to find tunnel pathogens, fungi, and Enrique Garza was one of the proponents back then. So they started to find the right strain to regulate locust population. They isolated different strains throughout Mexico.
But one of the most pathogenic potentials was found in this island. We see the very small island in that inside that yellow circle. Well, that's where the best results were obtained. To the right in the graph, Dr. Barrientos Lozano, who collaborated in 2002, she assessed the percentage of survival of the different swarms after days of treatment application. Untreated areas, we can see the bands survived up to 100%. But the accumulated strains of the fungi, we can see how after the second day, we see a decline. After day six, a peak begins again. And after the ninth day, we see a reduction. After 2 weeks, we see that the bands have been reduced. So biological control was found to be then effective, unlike insecticides. But it does not act as quickly as do insecticides. That was one of the findings. Biological control surfaces that were treated in the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico looks at the different peaks here. We see that through aerial applications, nearly 4,000 hectares were covered in the years that are stated there. And non-peak years mean that we are carrying out terrestrial control. We see the Nicosant fungi that is becoming a locust here. We see a fungus and then we see locusts. And this is a report last year prepared with Garcia Avila, some colleagues. We prepared a report stating how in entomopathogenic fungi, we applied control mechanisms. And this prevented populations from rising. Without areas that did not have biological control, we see the darker, we see the light colored circles, the populations are higher. But in 2010 up to 2017, populations have been self-regulated. Additional chemical and biological controls have been done, but they're very localized. Now, before these applications, these were areas that experienced outbreaks. Every year we had to go on site and carry out control efforts. But to attain this, much has to be done. The fungus has to be good quality for this purpose. Second, transportation. And third, application has to be effective. Because if each of these, or if any of these procedures fail, we will get undesired effects. So that's the story of biological control with this fungus. So this year, after a request that received an interest from the different countries that are ORISA countries, they asked Mexico for information on control of the strain. And we can see that the Plant Health Protection Director, Carlos Morales, signed this report. And he's informing in this letter the member countries that an event will be held and the fungi will be transferred, sent to the ORISA member countries for purposes of biological control. A workshop was held on October 1st through the 5th this month. And it was divided into two parts, conservation and of the mentorism. It was aimed at labs and the application of mentorism fungus on the locusts. To the left, we see conservation efforts on the first day, and the third day, the actual applications. So before carrying this out, it's very important to be trained, as has been emphasized today, to be able to successfully manage the locusts through these fungi. The map also shows how member countries, we can see the map later, how member countries, some have the strain already, some are producing them in their labs. And what follows are validation field
trials. And in that manner, native applications can be carried out in outbreak areas and recession areas as well. What's the challenge? Well, I'm including this map because we use as an example what China is doing for the Ligagoya locust. In China, it went from 5% in 2004 to 30% very recently. 100,000 hectares per year are being treated with Acridium fungi. Now, this study was published by Zhang and David Hunter that we see here in this picture. And this article was in the Journal of Orthoptera Research. So Dr. Shen received an award at the latest orthopterology conference. So that's a channel to increase the surface that comes under biological control for more effective management. So what are the perspectives? To develop biological control in the region as a preventive management component, if we don't include this component, this will be complicated. We must reduce the use of synthetic insecticides and conserve natural areas such as sources of water and also B areas or area nuclei and self-regulate the locust in key areas. And what do we seek? Self-regulation of locusts in these areas that have experienced outbreaks and to experience fewer outbreaks and reduce management costs. Since we're not dealing with outbreaks every 2-3 years. And thank you for your attention. I thank the panel and the organizers. It's always a pleasure to be here at ICA. I do thank you for inviting me. The Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, as well as the Locust Management Group. Thank you so much for inviting me. Thank you, Dr. Medina will speak about the use of computer-aided devices or computer technology in helping to control the South American locust. Thank you, Paula. So I'm going to try to be succinct about explaining the efforts we've made in cooperation with other countries and how we use computer technology to be able to deal with the situation. So when we detect a pest, we have two methods of rapidly being warned or rapid detection. One is through preventive efforts, as Dr. Poot just explained, or official monitoring or reports by the actual farmers. If we're dealing with crises such as Argentina, which has faced many critical situations in the past few years with this pest, they're continuously working out of the field, and you can actually see the pest. Once the pest is present, measures can be taken to deal with it. So what are the reporting mechanisms by the farmers? Argentina uses WhatsApp. It's the newest communication channel or social networks. And these are how farmers report the presence of pests. They email us, they can call us. But I think what's most important is this application that was developed by Senasa that farmers can then. It has a GPS device that shows where that band is found and then and the date. And then it's quickly uploaded to the cloud and we automatically will receive the information. And in real time, we see this information. We see the when he's seeing that or and what he's saying, and that way we can prioritize that report. SENASA's official and other governmental official platforms for dealing with monitoring are the following. This is not anything new. It's a system that collects information, monitoring information. It registers treatments, presences, absences, and detects where the locusts and grasshoppers have laid their eggs. In the past few years, this registry was also made available through a mobile application, and the information now travels quicker, so the farmer won't have to find a GPS and a pen to jot down the information collected. He can, with his smartphone or a tablet, register the information directly in the field. The application works offline. Once a signal, a wireless signal, is detected, then it's sent, and it reaches a database where it's processed. This is important because information travels quickly, which is of essence during emergencies. In addition, the individual that's actually carrying out the monitoring efforts many times is exhausted, given the fact that they're out in the field, and this simplifies his work. Now, we implemented efforts between Argentina, Bolivia, and Uruguay, as we mentioned before. We work through cooperation efforts through FARC, a cooperation fund, and we've exchanged information with these countries on the pest. And we've also transferred technology through to the different countries and unify our monitoring system. The mobile application can be used by other countries. These three countries thus become aware immediately of any issues. When I spoke about groups and GSP, we were trying to develop, we're now going to try to develop a tool that could be used throughout the hemisphere. We can see how the countries share information. These areas in yellow are areas that have been treated. Again, this is possible through transfer, through technology transfer. But it's also important for countries to be able to provide the information. That's what limits us the most. We have to be sure that the information that is conveyed is trustworthy information and is thus be able to be sent, and that the farmers have access to this. So there's a management protocol that deals with risks of locusts, and they publish the information continuously. This information will be sent to the producers, to the farmers. They learn how close the pest is, the crops from being impacted. But this is also very important for researchers. And for SENASA's day-to-day activities, well, they're not relevant, but researchers working on locusts find this of essence. Our national program for decision-making processes are comprised by a panel that includes the Minister of Ministry of Agriculture and other agricultural organizations in Argentina. It includes the weather organization that's dealing with monitoring of climate if there's rain, and this is important to be able to track the movement of the different swarms. We have an aerospatial commission, CONAI, that launched a second satellite. And in this manner, we obtain satellite information from the satellite directly, that which allows us to take action. We receive information on temperatures on intense winds. We used land surface maps and humidity maps for our land surfaces, and that shows what areas face the greatest risk of being prone to eggs of the locusts. So here we worked with France. It's a model that was approved in Africa as well to determine the potential distribution of locust swarms that move throughout the region, as you're well aware, of course. And these are the satellite images. According to Dr. Sidi Kure, that we work with in France, this model can be run to attain information that can be sent to third parties, and then SENASA can receive that information to be able to carry out samples in our country. CDQ also works with INTA, with Dr. Siriano's CONASEF team, that's also researching management of locusts in our countries. Dr. David Hunt and other experts that have been working with this baseline information collected by SENASA. How about the farmers? Well, we receive their reports, then we analyze the situation and tell them what's happening. This is a map showing risk areas in different provinces of Argentina, the risk level, location of swarms. This is published on a website, and you can see how the swarms progress, how it's distributed here. This is important for consultants dealing with economic analyses to understand the potential risk, economic damage as a result of the pests. In order to improve communication with farmers, we have a detection or an early warning system. If a swarm is seen, the team will register that in the mobile application. It's registered in a database. And there's an early warning system of farmers listed in another application. And then they convey that information to the farmers. Throughout a radio throughout radio communication, and then they sent out a message. So this is continuous monitoring. It's to inform them as to what's occurring in their area to prevent the pest from reaching their crops. So the farmer will receive an early warning and then a map as to where the pest is. And then we give them, provide all the information and redirect them to another organization for pest control. Manuals for air control as well. And just responses that can be taken. And the idea is to for him to understand if there are colonies close by. And we can also see a database that shows information that's updated every week. We see where swarms were, what areas reported eggs that were laid, and other key aspects are important for bee keepers. So, and we include livestock producers, beekeepers, and of course farmers, because we have protocols to deal with each sector. The end goal is to help conserve or preserve the work of the beekeepers. And just some conclusions. Technology advances rapidly, so we think that continuous training is necessary as to the latest technology. Now, they're not the solution in themselves, so we have to be able to use them effectively in the short, medium, and long term. And we can't belittle the work of individuals out in the field. Working out in the field are difficult, and if the locusts experts weren't working out in the field, our alert system, warning systems wouldn't make sense. There would be no beginning to the reporting mechanism. Another important aspect is that before unifying technology systems, we have to unify our technical responses, our own responses. So we need to complement efforts. The province, regional, private sector, national sector, as I mentioned, and researchers, and then provide information for them through technology. So we can, and we want to create virtuous cycles where everyone is benefited. We have many researchers that also use this database for publishing studies, and this is used readily for preventive purposes. So our challenge is to implement this unique system and use it with our neighboring countries. We're trying to find a single unique platform. The idea is to work together with remote monitoring and improve our plant protection intelligence and have developed better early warning systems. Now the next step is to be able to complement Argentina's response with these early detection systems. Thank you. Thank you, Hector. So to end the technical panel, we're going to, so we hereby end our technical block. And what we're going to do now is hold our comment period. And I'm going to invite the Paola Romero from the Ministry of Agriculture and welcome.
Good morning. From the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Argentina, I would like to present this on international cooperation. The purpose is to promote sustainable development and work through FOAR. Cooperation is the term defined in mixed technical cooperation meeting where we prepare annual work plans in line with the achievements of the 2030 agenda. We also promote the implementation of triangular cooperation projects. Some of our successful partnerships have been the ones established with GIZIT, TAICA, UNICEF, ICA, among others. In Latin America, 70% of technical cooperation focuses on this thematic area, and we would like to share some success stories in the region. For example, the success experience of the FOAR projects and for the control of the locust in South America with the cooperation of Bolivia, Paraguay, and Argentina. The project was implemented in 2017-2018, focusing on the detection, prevention, and control of the South American locust. Some of the results of this were joint training for leaders of the control teams, establishment in Bolivia of a national control program, and also a work task force for handling the South American locust between Argentina, Bolivia, and Paraguay. With regards to Mexico, during 2017 and 2018, a project was implemented to strengthen or to build capabilities to implement and manage national traceability systems. The counterparts were SENASA and SENASICA, and some of the results of the projects are the fact that we were able to refine the traceability system in Mexico, the surveillance disease system and health alerts in Mexico, and also integrated health management systems and georeference information. Good afternoon. And now we will begin sharing cooperation experiences with the Caribbean. And for this, we would like to share a video.
Argentina con el Caribe, un puente para
Argentine cooperation with the Caribbean.
El fomento de iniciativas sur-sur y triangulares en el Caribe constituye un eje prioritario de la cooperación argentina desde hace más de dos décadas. El Fondo Argentino de Cooperación Internacional, FUAR, promueve 11 proyectos en 14 países en ejes como agroindustria y seguridad alimentaria, salud y fortalecimiento de laboratorios y seguridad y justicia. Con el apoyo del Ministerio de Salud y Desarrollo Social y el Instituto Nacional de Tecnología Agropecuaria, el proyecto Pro Huerta Haití capacitó a más de 37.000 familias en la producción de alimentos frescos a partir de tecnologías de bajo costo. En Barbados, el Instituto Nacional de Investigación y Desarrollo Pesquero contribuyó al desarrollo de la pesca artesanal de langosta, fortaleciendo los sectores ictícola y turístico. Junto a la Organización Panamericana de la Salud, profesionales argentinos optimizaron los procesos de control de calidad en el laboratorio de referencia de la CARICOM. La Prefectura Naval Argentina brindó cursos de formación a las guardias costeras de Granada y San Vicente y las Granadinas. De esta manera, la cooperación argentina con el Caribe promueve el desarrollo sostenible e inclusivo y fortalece los lazos entre nuestros países.
Bueno, a través de la cooperación sur-sur y triangular,
South-South and triangular cooperation, our country has partnered with other countries in the region, multilateral organizations and civil society organizations. In this region in particular, in addition to the triangular cooperation, we have regional projects to simultaneously cooperate in different countries that have similar problems. On behalf of Argentina, we would like to point out one of the most successful experiences dealing with surveillance and antimicrobial resistance in the Caribbean region. This project was implemented together with the PAHO and CARICOM countries, and it is very important for the region, and it became even more relevant in light of the COVID-19 pandemic. We would also like to share information about another triangular initiative implemented by Argentinian experts from the Southern University together with ICA. This project is currently undergoing and is known as APICARIBE, the purpose of which is to improve honey productivity, and it is being implemented in Barbados, Dominica, St. Kitts and Nevis, and St. Lucia. This is a technical experience that, in addition to including beekeepers, is focused on cooperatives, gender focus, and on providing economic opportunities for the youth. Thank you for your attention. Thank you. And finally, and in line with the important and perspectives for regional cooperation, we would like to give the floor to Ms. Lourdes Bonajeras from ICA.
Hola, buenos días a todos.
Good morning to you all. Before I present on AIGA's cooperation on locusts, I would like to tell you that recently Ms. Adriana Guillen joined this meeting. I would like to welcome her and tell you about the work that she has been doing on AHFS, especially phytosanitary issues. She has a long-standing experience on strategic and regional work. Welcome, Adriana. And now, let's talk about AICA's technical cooperation in the area of locusts in the Americas. In addition to locust, ICA has defined a new cooperation model. that was a response to the changes that were accelerated by the pandemic. This is to identify future perspectives. And ICA, this way, is trying to become an international innovation platform that provides cooperation services, connecting the supply and demand of knowledge, especially with regards to public goods and with the relevant and quality persons. There are a few criteria that are being included in this new cooperation model. We need to understand the changes that accelerated the pandemic to better provide our cooperation services. We also need to adapt strategies, not only cooperation strategies, but also those strategies being used to reach the different sectors, the most vulnerable sectors in the different countries with different conditions. Another criterion that is a key importance is to innovate in strategies and in our management models. We need to have actions that have a real impact, that will change, that will make real changes. And this calls for adequate management models that will adapt to the new realities. In every case, we should prioritize the incorporation of technology. This was mentioned by Hector as one of the main aspects of any locust program. And also in the cooperation that ICA has provided in the area of locust, over the years, this has been one key issue. In addition to locust, all our future cooperation models and strategies is to prioritize the incorporation of technology. We would also like to promote the participation of all sectors that in one way or another are being affected by the problem, and also promote empowerment. We need to stop giving cooperation that will only promote or build capacities at a certain point in time, and then after that, they're lost. We need to promote empowerment to make this sustainable, to make our work sustainable. Something that ICA is promoting a lot is partnerships and public-private and public-public coordination, and this will be key for future projects that we will be working on. With regards to the prevention and management of locust, we need to consider this as a regional public good that calls for commitment of all actors who can benefit. To do this, we need to consider the main characteristics of the pest. The experts that came before me already mentioned that this is a voracious migratory cross-border plague, and that for those reasons, it is a regional public good, and this requires coordination between countries, sectors, and institutions. We also need to have joint strategies. We cannot have individual isolated strategies from one single institution. We need to have joint strategies. And one example of this is the program mentioned by Hector with the participation of Bolivia, Paraguay, and Argentina. And these needs to include the technical management and financial aspects. We also need to have participation of the state as a coordinator and to safeguard the most vulnerable producers. The locust is a voracious pest. And for this reason, the smallholder farmers are more affected than larger farmers. And that is why the participation of the state to safeguard these farmers is so important. finally, as for the next steps of IGAS cooperation in the America, today, currently, we are working with the support of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and SENASAN and the Ministry of Agriculture in Argentina in order to continue supporting even other regions such as Africa and India. We are working with SENASA and with a public-private effort on online courses for the locust to support the capacity to prevent and respond to locust emergencies. And these will be focused on the situation of each region. At IICA, we have the Technical Secretariat of the Inter-American Coordination Group on Plant Health, and from there we expect to continue supporting the work you're doing in locust and in other areas. This is the presentation I have for you. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you, Lourdes, and to the VCN team. We have completed the technical panel, and now we will move on to our discussion. We have 15 minutes to do this. We have received many questions, and the experts are trying to respond to those questions. We'll try to respond to those questions. We will begin with the first question from Navarro Morales. He's asking what control instruments are being used to combat the pest, and if you have identified some biological controls. Chemical control, as was explained by Dr. Mario Po, is the most important in terms of the amount that is being applied. And we also need to develop biocontrollers. There is some interesting progress in Central America and in other countries of the continent. But these are the two main alternatives, chemical and biological control. Understanding that a biological control needs to be further developed. And there are other alternatives such as the use of pheromones and other chemicals that are being explored, but that have not been applied in the field yet. As Hector was saying, chemical control is currently the fastest and most effective method. It may not be the best, but it is what we have available right now to respond to an emergency. Biological control could also supplement these efforts. There's also natural control with predators such as bees, parasitoids, bacteria, viruses. There are a number of organisms that can help control the populations, but sometimes there are so many locust populations that it would be impossible for natural organisms to control them by themselves. So we need to keep using the methods that we are currently using. Jose Herrera is asking with regard to the four species of Schistocerca. And I apologize for the way I'm pronouncing that, if they require different treatment. I don't want to be the only one to respond, but here we're talking about four similar species, so they are being treated similarly. The difference would be in whether this is an emergency situation, such as what we had in Argentina and other parts of South America, or if we are applying preventive treatment. So the purpose of this Inter-American locust group is to unify criteria and technical capabilities in the region to have a single procedure that will be adapted to each territory. Mr. Maripuz talked about the regional plan of OIRSA that is being adapted to the situation in each country. So in general, the treatment is very similar, but maybe Dr. Zimmer can explain to you about another tool that we have to control this pest. Thank you, Victor. In Peru, we have controlled two local species. We apologize, we're having audio problems. As I was saying, besides applying chemical or biological control, an important element is the application methodology. If we don't have a good methodology, for example, in areas where we have a scarce water, very little water, then we will have to use different logistics for the applications. We have developed an application methodology that allows us to control volume to reduce the pest. Using very little water. That way we can move ahead of the gregarious populations. And so the application technique is very important. And chemical or biological agents are important as well. But in Peru, we have given more importance to the application technology. Thank you, Ricardo. We have a question for Dr. Puig on whether there are any agreements with Argentina to use the Metsarhizium fungi. On that regard, well, this is a very good topic to analyze, and I believe that this is one of the areas that needs further study in upcoming meetings in our table. Some of the members that are here are part of this table, and the response to your question is yes, we are analyzing that, Hector, and the entire team. We will be working on this, but there is no formal agreement yet, but we will look at the possibility not only for the Oirirce region, but also in order to have our own strain. This will be further explored in the future. Thank you. Wilson Vasquez is asking whether you can have applied homopathogens at the beginning of the rainy season, and also a class of entomopathogenic fungi. Yes. One of the good things about biological control is that it doesn't harm the environment, or it has minimal impact. But we need to consider that before, everything we used required a lot of water, and now entomopathogenic application requires oil, and this protects against UV rays. Mr. Carlos Solano explained this as one of the principles of application. This is basic, not only for this methodology, but you also need to consider the type of agent, the vehicle. Before, we thought that we needed to use a lot of water, but in Africa, they are using biological control with oil and very little water. Oil protects the fungi, even with high humidity or high temperatures. Thank you.
Regarding mobile devices and Hector's presentation, is that tool available? Is that device available? I showed different devices. One had to be a farmer reporting device. And yeah, it's a public device. It's on our SENASA website. and the other applications are only available for authorities in Bolivia, Uruguay, and Argentina, and some municipalities as well. Their plant health protection agencies also use this centralized application to share data. So it's more of an official type application. Thank you for clarifying, Hector. There's a question from an individual saying if there is possible to carry out a study on a small land area that is under no type of control to see if natural predators will arise and that can develop into a good control mechanism. I don't know if I should answer to that. Maybe I don't want to monopolize all the responses. Natural predators, yeah, they do help self-regulate. But what's the problem with locusts? Locusts, under certain conditions, may be overpopulating the natural predators. So the impact of these natural predators may be 10% lower. So it would only 90% could migrate and cause damage. If there were a low population, natural predators would definitely do the job. But with an overpopulated site, that wouldn't work. Example, there's a cellular nesting, a celluloid, it's a parasitoid. And this is characteristic because it's laying where the locust eggs are laying underground, 15 meters underground. But we've analyzed only 10% of results. So that's very little compared to the locust population. So they can self-regulate, provided that the insect population or the pest population is low. Even predators, birds, we've seen animals that wild turkeys, we've even found 50, 90 nymphs can be controlled. But locusts just are so overpopulated that it's very hard to control with natural predators. Thank you. For being asked, if looking at the genus and types of locusts, if one could say that the Isefrons genus it poses the most damage with regards to consumption. The Peruvian locust, well, it's gregarious during its gregarious state. Consumption isn't a problem. It's so we haven't found any differences between the Territa and the Peruvian locust with regards to use or consumption, but dispersion does mark a difference. One will fly up to 500 meters high and the other one 800, but that's only in areas of more mountain areas. That's the only difference. But we don't see this with we don't see this difference. That is no, we don't see that the difference is noteworthy.
Participación, pues efectivamente, no. Lo que hace diferente a Esquistocerca pisiferons pisiferons.
What makes a difference from Esquistocerca pisiferons pisiferons is the gregarious nature of that locus. We know that when populations are gregarious with bands or swarms or blots, they cause the greatest impacts in agriculture because they feed off of vegetation. But the problem is when they feed off of crops. So that's the trend. They they are of a gregarious type, and that makes it a dangerous type of locust for Central America and South America. Thank you for your answers. Leopoldo Serrano mentions where he can get more information on current taxonomic keys for Latin American agrides. I didn't mention that the information that I showed in my first presentation, the tables, they're all available in the in our website, the GICSV. But what's most important is the World Optoptera Catalog. They have the most updated information. There's a link, if you go to the GICSV website, there's a link to that taxonomic information that you're requesting. Question, have some areas where the metarhizium has been applied, if it's also impacted other insect species? No. When metarhizium has been applied, no impact is caused on other organisms. That's why it's used. It's Metarhizium acridium, which is from acrites. What we have observed is that it impacts other grasshoppers that are related with that order. Effects have been studied on labs, effects on bees, beneficial insects, for example. There have been effects, but it's an impact of approximately 5% on bees, for example. It's minimal. If we compare with this with insecticide or chemical insecticide applications, which would be 95%. So the effect is minimal on our natural predators, but definitely on other Optoptera. Thank you for your clear explanation. Okay, two more questions. Quintina Navarro is saying, what are the crops that are most impacted by locusts? And someone is asking also about Necroceros cistosaracoides in Colombia. Is monitoring is being done because, or monitoring should be done because it causes tremendous damage, and it caused an important outbreak in 1990. One of the most important characteristics of locusts is that they are they can feed. They're polyphasetic. They can feed off of any sort of vegetation, and as Jesus said, when they impact grassland, they also consume native species, and they have. And Mario could answer about the can answer as to what are the crop general information about the locusts, just that define it as being very complex. But it. The probability of affecting a large number of farmers is very high, so that is what we have to prevent. The gregarious state in Peru does not pose any sort of complications. In 2001, there were swarms in an area, the area of Cajamarca, and due to the weight itself, they destroyed many crops and even wild species. When they're solitary, they prefer grasses and wild vegetation areas, but not in a gregarious state. Its voracity and it feeds off of any crop, which puts any sort of crops at risk, wherever these swarms may move towards. To respond to the question on Matoceros, it's known as the coastal locust, but it's not a locust, it's a grasshopper. And we understand that there was a recent outbreak in the coastal side of Colombia. Colombia has worked to control that. It has been one of the most significant pests in Brazil 20 years back, but there have been no recent issues with that species in Brazil recently. Thank you. Okay, there's still many pending questions, but we are out of time. We do thank you for all of your questions and this wealth of information that was shared. I'm going to allow Antonieta then to facilitate the closing session. Thank you, Pau. So we're going to close our seminar. We're going to give the floor to Diana Guillen. She is from the Ministry of Agriculture, Livestock, and Fishing of Argentina. She's the minister. Oh, good afternoon. It's already afternoon here. Thank you for inviting me. Allowed me also to see many colleagues that I haven't seen in a while. This new normalcy really has been leveraged by Zoom because we're able to see people we haven't seen in years. And I can't really say I'm tremendously thrilled with having to speak on a conference having to do with locusts, because we should have already resolved this issue. But it's a recurring issue, and it keeps on coming back. When we think we've solved it and we've eradicated it, the pest shows us that viruses are resistant, and they find the way to thrive. So this is a pre-Columbian pre-colonial pest, as our Mexican neighbor said, and it's also in the Bible. So remember, the only way of dealing with this and making any sort of headway with these pests is do what we're doing now. Exchange possible experiences, exchange not only experiences, but help each other. According to Lourdes, it's a trans-border pest. It doesn't understand any sort of boundaries among regions. When Lourdes said that, the one area of Argentina is near mountain region. It's Catamarca, Tucumán, Salta. But the damage in the northeastern side was from swarms coming from the west. So this pest does not respect any sort of boundaries. And if we do not pay heed to that, it will quickly overpopulate. And if the right climate variables coincide, it can be disastrous. The farmer can't curtail this with itself because it's voracious. It has this dynamic of traveling and crossing borders. So we require the farmers to communicate with the state and with the provinces. The state has to communicate with the provinces and add technology to that. I am thrilled that technology has now become a part of our control methods for this pest. So let's begin to envision and observe what progress we can make with biological control. Our past experience in Argentina with biological control, well, is the following. If the density is very high, the pest will override that. We have to have more than one way of dealing with controlling pests. I'm sorry I arrived late and I will no longer keep you. I do congratulate you. I would like to say hello to my colleagues, to Will Wobert, and just mention that these workshops are the road ahead. They make us use technology, and we have to leverage on technology. Thank you. Thank you, Minister. Now, President of COSAVE, Cesar de la Cruz, will remark. Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome the COSAVE, or say hello to COSAVE, and to the experts that today made presentations on such an important topic. This topic is regional, of great regional interest. And we have to work or to strive to attain surveillance and control it. So if we act in a timely manner, we can limit or at least avoid severe damage to occur. So thank you so much for inviting me. Good afternoon. Thank you, Cesar. We're going to give the floor once again to Minister Alicia Barón from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Argentina. Thank you, Antonieta. So we arrived at the end of the second virtual seminar of for cooperation, regional cooperation between Latin America and the Caribbean. I'd like to thank the delegates and representatives from regional organizations of plant protection experts for sharing their know-how on this very complex topic. I'd like to thank ICA and FAO representatives from the Ministry of Agriculture and Livestock, from the healthcare services and healthcare institutes of the region, international cooperation agencies. And I would like to send warm regards to ISIN. I'd like to thank ambassadors and universities, academia, researchers, students, everyone who has connected, farmers and representatives of agricultural chambers. Thank you so much for meeting with us. And I hope you enjoyed and learned from our workshop, which includes representatives from 32 countries. Given this complex scenario, international cooperation continues to be an effective instrument for institutional strengthening through exchange of best practices and knowledge. I hope that this initiative will help to coordinate regional responses to deal with this threat and other threats to food security. Thank you. Thank you, Minister. So we thank the organizers, the experts who were our speakers, and all the different institutional authorities that attended. We're going to hold the third virtual conference on November 28th with participation from regional countries as well as African countries. We will be inviting you to that conference as well. Hopefully, if you have not been able to see the entirety of this presentation and you would like us to send you a link, feel free to reach out to us and we will send the recording. So we hereby end the Second Regional Cooperation Seminar for Latin America and the Caribbean. And you can also access this meeting on SENASA's YouTube channel, Argentina's SENASA's YouTube channel. Thank you and have a wonderful afternoon.
Yes.